This is part two of the fantastic Tektronix 7612D. If you missed part one, please go and check out the link in the description. So the power supply is of course not mounted because that is a part one thing. Let's look a little bit on the different internal stuff here in this unit. Like I said before, it is using two remote controllable analog input stages. They are more or less also used in their oscilloscopes. I definitely believe those are also oscilloscope plug-in modules. But those are the one with the completely programmable inputs. So of course we got two individual analog channels, and that is because everything here is doubled. This unit samples everything analog, or it takes everything here analog to the two CRTs. We're going to open all this CRT section as well. We can take a tiny little glimpse of the digital sampler. It is down there. We've got a CPU section, a DA section. Can't remember what exactly that is. We got storage here as well, the memory. So I think I'll just take these this off. I remove that one so we can go and inspect the different modules. So the first one, I start counting them like this, adding numbers here, so I'm not going to do it wrong when I put stuff back. But the first one here is the memory and the CPU section. And it's actually a double card like that. So it's a stacked card. And each of these two boards, that's six layer design. Look at that. It's quite beautiful, the design, and it's clearly done manually. We got some information here on the design dates, 1979. I saw 1978 on the boards in the power supply, so that was probably what they started with. And I also see 80 and 81 for the dates of release of the different boards. And officially this product was released in 81, so it took them quite some years to design this product, and I would expect that because it's a very, very complicated unit. So here we got tons of EEPROMs. So this is all the different software for it. We got address bus and data bus connected down with the interconnects here that goes to the CPU card. And it is, of course, a 6800 from a Motorola. That's the brain of everything here. So this is just CPU, timing, additional support chips, the 6821. And everything here is in a very, very good shape. I don't see that many decoupling capacitors, by the way. So that's a little bit funny. See, there's a melt fuse. So in case there is a short here, well, we actually got two fuses, right? We've also got some analog parts here. And card number two here is a combined IEEE interface and the XYZ, so the analog output interface for oscilloscopes. And this way you can see real time what is going on. And it's also a six layer board. I really like the layer indication here. And this one is designed in 78. At least the layout is done in 78. And you see 80 written on the date codes. And there is a final inspection and date here, that is 81. So we got a little bit of oops stuff here on the bottom side. So some signals they kind of forgot or they wanted to do in another way. And of course this one was probably a pre or an early version of this design. So you even see two sockets here that's unpopulated, so you could add extra ICs and add some extra wires for modifications and stuff like that. So that is pretty neat. Yeah, see that wire there goes through the hole and then it comes up where, oh, look at that. So it's not supposed to go to that the pad, but it goes to the IC. So that is funny. Yeah, so we of course got two analog amplifiers here for the two X, Y, and Z is just the brightness control. So that is not, it's just on off keyed, I guess, for blanking, right? Really beautiful layout here. Huh, look at those tracks. Purely analog layout style. I kind of like it. So board number three here is the analog input board for both channel A and channel B. And as you can see here, it's clearly marked with A and B, and we got plus minus here and external. And again, plus minus and external, and they go in coax cables. So it's a six layer board as well, also designed in 78. So here we go, 80 megahertz bandwidth. Really nice stuff here. What I think is interesting is that the rear side is shielded using another little circuit board. And look at that. It's also divided into two different shields between the two channels. And they even used a three-layer board to make the shield. I mean, no expense spared whatsoever, right? They just wanted this to be maximum. Oh, this is nice. Let's zoom in a little bit on some of the ICs here. Got a DAC up there. We got some custom tech parts. No surprise there. I know this unit is full of custom chips specially developed for this product. Yeah, and down here we got the trigger. It says trigger, so it's probably all that kind of stuff that is doing that. Board number four, we are counting from this way, is a translator board. So this one is a seven layer board. And you can see through quite a lot of the layers, by the way. There must be a lot of crosstalk when you put tracks directly on top of each other like that. See, the distance down to the next layer is really, really low. This is not how I would do it today. But of course this is also not the kind of speed that we do stuff today, right? Oh, we got three fuses, so that means three different voltages on this board. A lot of stuff runs on negative 5 volts and a lot of stuff runs on positive 5 volts. This is just the way that they have shared the power around everything here. This is a funny little dead bug fix. So this is a little feature upgrade. Maybe you want to see the bottom side as well. And again, we can of course see through a lot of layers. And it's also completely manual, the layout here. I kind of like it. Can you imagine doing this on transparent plastic? That would have been so much fun to do. And here we got the 7-layer identification. 2 ground planes here, that's probably the supply layers, right? The next 2 modules, I call them 5 and 6, they're identical. And they're called data storage. They look really, really beautiful. So it's also 6-layer design. And here it looks like we got 8 bits of data storage. Everything here goes in 8 of this and 8 of that. And that will be the memory chips. Well, the fun thing is that we only got 4 bits of data out here for measuring or some check. It's quite nice with the points for your scope probe, so you can scope around and stuff. So there's a little funny connector here in the bottom right corner. And there's even a shield like that. Why the heck is that made like that? So this one is from 1978. And the bottom side is also just as fantastic. Look at those tracks, the way that they are absolutely manually made. Oh yeah, this connector here, see? Here it's just looped directly over, and there's another connector that is free. That connector goes down here to the next data storage module, which is exactly the same, right? And then, yeah, it kind of fell out when I pulled up this module and I didn't even feel it. So now I need to go and put it back before I pull out the other one. But the other one, both of these are connected. See, this cable go here, and then on the other one, it goes to, I think, so we got data storage on both sides, and those are also identical, right? And 2 and 2 of them got a coax cable that is called OR. So this is the OR gate, if you're using this one or that one, I guess. So they're probably cascaded, the 2 data sections somehow, right? And this will be the data generation storage kind of stuff, right? Wow, man, it is just amazing. Quite a lot of space between the boards. This could have been a lot more compact. Let's see if we can get the MB7072N from Fairchild. So that's the memory chips. And those you can probably not Google either. Ooh, we got a little funny thing happened here with that pin. So we see a little bit of bug fixing. So I needed to go and have a look at the bottom. So this is the main interconnect board that goes the CPU board and the XYZ and the trigger board and all that kind of stuff here, right? And that will be the data storage and the data in outboards. And by the way, the main interconnect board here is a 9-layer board. I think it is time to get a little bit impressed. Whoa, whoa, whoa. A 9-layer board. I think that is a new all-time high for 1978. Let's see, is this... where is the... It's probably on the other side. But this one is probably also designed in 1978 because that one is definitely designed before everything else, right? You need to know how to connect stuff before you can design the other boards, right? But this one is manufactured in... also in 81. And here's another proof that this one is also not made on a computer. You wouldn't do the tracks like this if it would have been on a computer. So it's all completely manually routed. Yeah, this was the data. So this is the data kind of extender stuff. So here goes data in and out, right? And then it goes from the first one to the next one. And this tells the module that it's connected like a data in series kind of thing. It gotta be something with that, right? And that is to the front panel stuff. And that is the other data storage modules. So all we have to do is pull out one of these just to have a look, because those are also identical. I'll take out the cables here first, and then I will flip the unit. So this is what I call module number 7. This is a time base. It says here, time base. This module is really, really heavy because it's super packed with ICs. And it is an 8-layer board. And it's designed in 1977. So this is so far the oldest designed board I've found in this unit. Maybe we should have a little look at the... I see. So this is manufactured in 80. We got a lot of... Yeah. Motorola parts there, definitely. All over the place here. And Fairchild as well. And all the fuses there, okay. Capacitors, looks like good health. This is actually a few little wires and modifications here on the back side. There's a little dummy out here. See, this one was glued all the way out here to the edge, so they had to press this so it cracked off. Why would anybody solder the wire all the way to the edge when they know the boards go into the slide in here, right? I mean, it goes quite deep, like 3 millimeters in. So why would you do that? I mean, you should know that when you're doing modifications. So that's a little bit funny. Here you can enjoy the block diagram while we end part 2 of this video.